Welcome to the lecture series on microcontroller programming. So in the series of lectures we'll be seeing the various languages that are used to program the microcontroller. And in the previous classes, in the previous class we have seen what is the need for an instruction set 2.6, and we have also seen the instruction format and we have seen the various classifications of instruction set. So if you see this in brief, what we have seen in the last class of our lecture series, so just we have gone through what is meant by an instruction. So there we have seen the instruction is written in program till the microprocessor to carry out a particular operation, or I can say that instruction provides a set of primitive operation. Instruction set provides a set of primitive operations which are combined together by programmer to realize any given task. So manam oka task ichinappudu, to perform the task, the microcontroller is required to perform a number of small operations. And to perform each small operation, we have to give one instruction. And what are all the various instructions that we can give for 8051 microcontroller are commonly called as instruction set. And this instruction set is actually required or needed to access all the registers that are there for your 8051 and to access the entire internal and external memory efficiently. And it also needed, the instruction set is also needed for efficient use of the remaining microcontroller hardware like timers and controllers and IO ports, etc. So after that we have seen how an instruction will be. So what are the various parts of instruction and what each part of instruction tells or specifies or instructs or the microcontroller. So there we have seen that an instruction is a command to the microprocessor to perform a given task on a specified data, to perform a given operation on a specified data. So every instruction will tell the microcontroller or processor to perform some operation. So operation on what? Operation on a specified data. So every instruction must convey the controller that it has to perform a particular operation on a particular data. So there we have seen that an instruction contains two parts. One is called opcode and another is called operand part. So opcode part always specifies the type of operation to be performed by the microcontroller, and operand part specifies the data on which the operation is to be performed. Operation here means it can be anything. If you take a arithmetic operation, it can be addition, multiplication, division, subtraction, etc. In the same way, you have other operations, logical operations, etc. So there we have seen number of examples, example instructions, and there we have shown what is the opcode part and what is the operand part and how the controller will understand the instruction and how it is going to execute. And after that we have given a classification of instructions based on the amount of memory they take when they are stored inside the microcontroller and they are stored in a memory. So if a instruction takes only 1 byte or if instruction size is 1 byte, then we will call it as 1 byte instruction or will fall into 1 byte instruction category. And if a instruction takes 2 bytes of memory, then it will come under 2 byte instruction category. And if an instruction takes 3 bytes of memory, it will come under 3 byte instruction category. There we have seen that the first byte of any instruction is always opcode, and if at all there are any remaining bytes, they will be part of the operand. So there we have seen in detail 1 byte instruction and 2 byte instruction and 3 byte instructions. And what will be the remaining bytes for the 2 byte and 3 byte instruction, that we have seen in detail. Later we have seen another classification of the instruction set or the instructions of the 8051 microcontroller, and they are now classified based on the type of operation they perform. So previously the classification is based on the amount of memory they occupy, the amount of memory they occupy, or the number of bytes a particular instruction takes. And now it is the classification, this classification is based on the type of operation performed by an instruction. So there we have classified all the instructions of the 8051 into 5 groups: data transfer, in arithmetic, logical, branch group, boolean group. Depending on what is the type of operation is performed when a particular instruction is executed by the microcontroller. So in today's lecture we'll look at one more interesting topic, that is called addressing modes. So what is addressing modes? Before going to this, you can see that we have told that an instruction is a command to the microcontroller to perform a particular operation on the specified data. Okay, and there we have seen that so the instruction has two parts, opcode and operand part, where the opcode part specifies the operation to be performed and it is directly mentioned as a mnemonic in case of assembly language instructions, right? So then the second part is operand part. So there we need to specify the data. So that means, so the data can be directly given in the instruction or it can be stored somewhere else, because our controller has a lot of storage options like registers and memory locations. So when we give an instruction, that means the controller has to perform certain operation on specified data. So then now, where the data is present actually? Is the data is present directly in the instruction or directly given in the instruction on which the operation is to be performed? This is the one case. And you can also specify or you can also store the data in registers, because you also have an option of registers where you can store the data in microcontroller. And you also have an option of storing the data in memory, either internal or external memory. And you can tell the microcontroller that the data that is to be operated on is either stored in registers or is either stored in memory location or either it is directly given in the instruction. So these various ways of accessing or specifying the data to the microcontroller is called addressing mode. Okay, so we are telling in the instruction itself by various ways that where is the data present on which the operation is to be performed to the microcontroller, and these various ways are called as addressing modes. So we have number of ways of telling the microcontroller that where the data is present on which the operation is to be performed. So those various ways are called addressing modes. Okay, so and we are going to discuss a few addressing modes which are very important to us, and they are named as, oh, first one is immediate addressing mode, and second one is direct addressing mode, and third one is register addressing mode, and fourth one is register indexed addressing mode. So don't worry about this, all this naming, and you will get to know clearly how the names are given, how the addressing modes are given with such names, and what is the meaning of the name of the addressing mode. The next one is indexed addressing mode and register specific addressing mode. You can see that immediate, direct, register, register indexed, indexed, register specific addressing modes. So in total we have 6 addressing modes here, and that will, so what is addressing mode? It is a way of specifying where the data is located to the microcontroller. Okay, so these are the 6 ways how we can specify that the data is present, that the data is present in certain location to our microcontroller when it want to execute a particular instruction, right? So we'll come to the first one, the immediate addressing mode. So what is meant by immediate addressing mode? So here, see, all these are just to specify the controller that where the data is present. Okay, so here in immediate addressing mode, the data that is to be used by the controller when it want to execute the instruction is provided in the instruction itself. Okay, is provided in the instruction itself, right? So the data is directly provided in the instruction itself, and you can see that, you can see an example here, move a comma hash 56h. So we already seen that, we already told that whenever a number preceded with hash symbol, the number is a data. Okay, so the number is a data. So here 56h is a data, and you can see that in move a comma hash 56h, I can say that 56h is the source operand and a is the destination operand. We have already told that the operand part of the instruction can have two more parts again. One is destination operand, and other is the source operand. So this side is whatever is there to the left of this comma will be destination operand, and whatever there to the right of this comma will be source operand. So that means the data is copied from source to destination location, right? So now here you can see that move a comma hash 56h. So here if you see in detail, what is the opcode here? MOV. So this opcode specifies the operation of copy the data from where to where, from source location to the destination location. So but what is the data on which the controller has to operate? And the data on which the controller has to operate is directly specified in the instruction itself. Directly specified instruction itself as a source operand. So that is why this type of instruction will come under, or will be using, I can say that it is using immediate addressing mode. As the data is specified in the instruction itself. And now, when a controller execute this instruction, what happens? This 56H data will be copied to the register A. So similarly, so here 56H is an 8-bit data. So here the data can be 8-bit or 16-bit. But you can see that it will be copied to matching register. That means since it is 8-bit data, it should be copied to 8-bit register only. So if at all, if the instruction uses 16-bit data, so here you can see the example, MOV DPTR comma hash 3456H. So since there is a hash 3456H is the data, and you can see that it is a 16-bit data, 3456, 4 digits in hexadecimal. So when it is converted to binary, it will become 16-bit. So 3456 is 16-bit data, and it will be copied to a 16-bit register DPTR. Okay. So what is more important apart from this copying is the data on which the controller is operating, are the data used by the controller when it want to execute the instruction, the data is directly given in the instruction itself. So this type of instruction using immediate addressing mode. So this is immediate addressing mode. Right. So you can see that the in immediate addressing mode, the data can only be present as a source operand, not as a destination operand, because the movement of the data is from source to destination. Because if you keep 56 as the destination, it is the data, not the location, right? So you cannot write the keep the data in destination location, but you can keep the data in source location. Okay, right. So next one we will see what is mean by one more addressing mode, the direct addressing mode. So what is mean by direct addressing mode? So in direct addressing mode, the data is present, the 8-bit data is present in the internal memory location or internal RAM, and its address is specified in the instruction. So for example, I can say that here we have an example, MOV 47H comma A. So when you see the instruction, MOV is the opcode, which means that to copy the data from where to where, again from source to destination. So what is the source here? Register A. So something, some data is there in the accumulator. So in order to match with the example, we'll change it somewhat. So nothing to worry, both instructions are correct only. Whatever the instruction we have written previously is also correct. So we have written instruction move A comma 47H, and here you can see that the data to be copied from 47H to A. But what is 47H here? So since there is no hash before 47, it is not a data, not a data. But what is it? So it is an address. Address of what? Address of a particular memory location of the internal RAM. You can see that here we have shown in the diagram internal RAM, and it has number of memory locations, and each memory location will have an address. And you can see this memory location has address 46H, this one has 47H, and this one has 48H as the address of this memory location. And now what is the meaning? So now this memory location has 47H address, and some data is there in this particular memory location. And when we write this instruction move A comma 47H, means data must be copied from 47H memory location to accumulator. That means some data is there in this memory location with address 47H, and this data must be copied to accumulator or register A. So here if you see that in this instruction, the data on which the controller has to operate, or the data is specified to the controller not directly by giving in the instruction, as like this one. We have not specified the data in the instruction, so it is not immediate addressing mode. But how we specified the data? We specified the data by giving its address, 8-bit address of memory location where it is present. Data is present in memory location, but its address is given in the instruction. So this instruction will tell the controller that go to memory location whose address is 47H. There you will find one data byte and copy that data byte into register A. So this is how we specified about the data to microcontroller. That means you go to memory location with address 47H, there you will find the data, and that data is to be moved, copied to the accumulator. So this is the direct addressing mode where we specify the address of the memory location where the data is present actually, right? So I think you have understood clearly about these two addressing modes. In immediate addressing mode, we specify the data directly. The data is specified to the microcontroller by writing the instruction, by writing in the instruction itself. In the direct addressing mode, the data is specified by writing the address of the memory location in the instruction. So here we have written 47H, which is the address of the memory location where data is present. So next we'll go to move on to third addressing mode, the register addressing mode. So in register addressing mode, we will see here how the data is specified to the microcontroller. So here the data is specified to the microcontroller that it is located in some registers such as R0, R1, R2, R7, R register A, register B, or DPTR. Okay, so we'll say that the data on which the operation is to be performed is located in some registers. This is how we specify that where the data is present to our microcontroller. You can see that one example of such instruction is MOV A, R5. So that means opcode operation is copy, that is move, copy. And where, so copy, what to copy? So what data is to be copied, and where the data is present, and how we are specifying the data? So that is by using register names. That means, so what this instruction, when it is executed, what operation is performed means, the data that is present in R5 register is copied to register A. So the data on which the operation is performed is present in R5 register and its name is written in the instruction. So that is why it is register addressing mode. Okay. So the data is specified by writing the register name in which it is present. Okay. The data is specified to the microcontroller by writing the name of the register in which the data is present. Okay. So similarly, we have an example ADD A, R4. Here you can see that addition operation is performed. Addition must be performed on two data bytes. What are the two data bytes? And where the data bytes are present? The data bytes are present in the registers A and R4. So their names are written in the instruction, so this belongs to register addressing mode. Okay, and next you can see that whenever we are using register addressing modes, that means the data is specified by using register names, the source and destination will be register names, and if you are writing in that way, the source and destination registers must match in size. Either these two are 8-bit size, or either these two are of 16-bit size. So one should not be 8-bit, one should not be DPTR, another should be A, B, it should not be like that. Okay. And one more thing is that of data so the movement of data between the R N registers is not allowed. You can see that R N registers means here N can be 0 to 7. That means between R N registers means between R0, R1, R2, R3, R N, R7. That means if you write an instruction MOV R3, R5, so this source and destination registers cannot be both R N registers. That means you cannot write the instruction move R3, R5, move R3, R1. Both cannot be RN registers. In that case, it is an invalid instruction or a wrong instruction. So you have to keep this in mind when you are writing instructions. So here in particular, what we need to focus on is register addressing mode means the data is specified by writing the names of the registers where the data is actually present. Okay, so right, next we'll go to one more addressing mode, one more way of specifying the data, and that is register indirect addressing mode. So here also, how we specify where the data byte is present on which operation is to be performed. So here we'll specify, here actually the data byte is present in one of the memory locations of internal RAM. So here, for example, you can say this is the internal RAM, and here are there are the memory locations, and this memory location has address 53H, this one has 54H, this one has 55H. So here, where my data byte is present for this example means, I assume that my data byte is present in the memory location with address 54H. And now what is the operation to be carried out? I want to carry out the operation that the data byte present in this 54H is to be copied to accumulator. Then in register indirect addressing mode, how I specify my data byte is present here? How I am specifying means, I am specifying the data by storing its address, storing the address of its memory location in one of the register, say R0 or R1. So and see how I am doing actually, what is the operation I have to carry out? I have to copy the data byte present in 54H memory location to accumulator. So this is the operation to be performed. But how I am specifying the data, or how I am telling the controller that where the data byte is present? So for that, what I am doing is, I am storing the address of this memory location in a register, say R0, and the register name I am writing in the instruction. So here you can see the instruction will be written in this way, MOV A, but here there is a new symbol @R0. So this is not at the rate, generally not it is called as @, but here it is announced as @address of. So this symbol means here @R0. So what is the how the controller will understand or how it will find the data to perform this move or copy operation is, so what it has to copy actually? So it has to copy from source to destination. Source is this @R0 or @R0 is a source operand. So what is destination location? Register A. So what, how it will understand? So @R0, what is there in R0? 54H. @R0 54H, you can see my cursor how it is going, @R0 54H, there is a data byte. there is a data byte. Copy this data byte to accumulator. I'm repeating again. So how the controller will locate the data, or how we are specifying data to controller, is move, that means a copy operation, from where to where, from destination location to source location, that is to register A. So what is destination location? It is at the address of R0, that is, what is there in R0? 54H. So what is there at 54H? 54H, there is a data byte. So at the address of 54H, we have a data byte. Copy the data byte into accumulator. So this is how we specify the register, how we specify the data, and this way of specifying the data is called as register indirect address mode. So in order to write instruction using register addressing mode, you can use either of the registers R0 or R1 to store the address of the internal memory location where your data byte is present. Okay, so similarly I can have an instruction move at the rate of at the address of R1 to A. That means whatever there is in the accumulator is moved to the memory location whose address is present in R1. So similarly, we can have another instruction move at the rate of DPTR comma A, right? So again, I am just have a brief look at these two addressing modes. In register addressing modes, the data is specified by writing the name of the register where it is stored, and in register indirect addressing mode, the data is present in actually internal memory location, in certain memory location of the internal RAM, and the address of that memory location is present in a register, and that register name is specified in the instruction by using the symbol at the address of, right? So next we'll go to the remaining addressing modes, and the fifth addressing mode, it is called indirect indexed addressing mode. So indexed addressing mode is actually used to address, or used to access the program memory. That means the memory in which the instructions are stored, or the memory in which the code or the program is stored. So to access that memory, we'll be using the indexed addressing mode. So in the indexed addressing mode, so this is same as your the previous one, register indirect addressing mode, but here this is indexed addressing mode. Here also you can see one example, MOVC here. This is different from MOV simply. How it is different means the simply MOV is this for accessing data memory, that is RAM, and MOVC is for accessing the program memory, that is ROM, read only memory. So this MOVC specifies access the program memory. Okay. Or MOVC means copy the data from program memory. Okay, right. So how the instruction is written? MOVC A comma at the address of A plus DPTR. So this is similar to the previous one, except here there we have R0 R1 after at the address of, here we have A plus DPTR. So it is very similar. So the instruction means copy the data byte present at the destination location to the source location, which is register A. Okay. So but what is the destination location? It is at the address of A plus DPTR. So at the address of A plus DPTR means, so in register A you have some data is there, some address. Okay, so at the rate of means these two contents of these two registers A plus DPTR will give you the address. So at the address of this memory location, you have a data byte. Copy the data byte into register A. So we'll look at one example here. So for this example, if you see that if you want to access a program memory location with the address say 1020H, so assume that this is an our program memory, and here we have number of memory locations, and the address of this memory location is 1020H, and the address of this one is 1019H, and the content of 1020H memory location is 25. It contains the data byte 25H. Now I want to copy this 25H into accumulator. If I want to copy the data byte present in the program memory at the address of 1020H into the accumulator, how we have to do this? First, load the data pointer register with 1000H and accumulator with 20H. Now what our instruction will tell? Move C A comma at the rate of A plus DPTR. So A plus DPTR means 100H plus 20H. What it will become? 1020H. So that means at the rate of 1020H, that means at the address of 1020H, you have a data byte, that is 25H. Copy the data byte to accumulator. So this instruction will move 25H data byte to accumulator. So this is almost same as the register indirect addressing mode, but here register indirect addressing mode is used to access internal RAM. There we use only either R0 R1 to store the address, but here indexed addressing mode is used to access the program memory, but here the address is stored in the two registers, register A and DPTR, and when you add the contents of A and DPTR, you will get the address of the memory location where data byte is present, and this DPTR is used if you are accessing external program memory which is present outside your microcontroller. And if the program memory is present inside microcontroller, instead of DPTR you have to use program counter. So this is the second instruction we have written. Okay, so indexed addressing mode, so here the whatever the address that is present in our DPTR will be called as a base address, and whatever the address that we are adding to this base address which is present in the accumulator is called as offset address. Okay, so the total address of the memory location is obtained by adding the base address present in DPTR to offset address present in accumulator. So there you will get the total complete address, and when you write this instruction A comma at the rate of that complete address, you go to that memory location and there it will locate the data byte, and that data byte will be used in the operation of copy. So finally 25H is copied to accumulator. So this is the indexed addressing mode. And next we look at the remaining addressing mode, that is called register specific addressing mode, or sometimes it is also called implied addressing modes. So when you write instruction by using that, or the instruction using these addressing modes, will specify the data to microcontroller, or will tell the microcontroller to locate the data automatically. That means the controller will understand where the data is present. Okay, where the data is present automatically. So the data located always in a specific register such as AR DPTR. So The controller will understand automatically where the data is present. For example, we'll write an instruction CPL comma A. CPL here is mnemonic for the operation complement. So complement the data. So where the data is present? So the data is present in accumulator. And this is automatically understood by your controller. Similarly, RR, one more instruction, RR comma RRA, rotate right. So what is to be rotated, where the data is present, that is to be rotated right. The controller will understand that the data is present in the accumulator and that data must be rotated right by 1 bit automatically. So this is register specific addressing mode, or I can say that implied addressing mode. So this gives you the complete details about the addressing modes, the 6 addressing modes, and what is, how the instructions are written by using these 6 addressing modes, and how each and every way of specifying the data or addressing mode will tell the microcontroller where the data is present, right? So this is very important, and you have to understand it thoroughly to understand the logic when we write programs. The next, one more thing, important topic, particularly about the 8051 microcontroller, is the bit level addressing. This is a very important feature of the 8051 microcontroller, that each single bit can be addressed, or single bit can be located or manipulated separately. Okay, so though we are saying that each memory location can accommodate 1 byte of data, and 8051 is 8 bit microcontroller, that means it can operate on 8 bits of data. When it want to perform operation, it also has feature of operating on single bit out of this 1 byte, right? So this is the most important feature of 8051, which making it to use in many practical applications, like for example sensing a switch or flashing an LED. So when you want to sense a particular switch, whether it is on or off, so on or off can be detected by using a single bit. So if a bit is 0, then I can say that it is off, it is in off condition. If a bit is 1, I can say that the switch is in on condition. Similarly, flashing an LED. LED on, I can indicate by using 1 bit, 1 for on, 0 for off. So when you have the facility of addressing or manipulating only single bit, the program required to perform the task will take less amount of memory, and the program will be very simple, and it is readable and easy to debug, and it takes very less memory. Okay, so instead of manipulating the entire byte of data for the sake of that single bit, if you have the facility of manipulating this only 1 bit, then you can save a lot of memory required by the program. And this feature is available in your 8051, where you have bit level, bit addressable RAM is there, okay? And you can access the program status word bits individually, okay? And to access all these, the individual bit addressable area of the RAM and individual pins of the I/O ports and the individual bits of your program status word, to know the status of the arithmetic operation, you have number of bit level instructions, and they can address the each and every individual bit by writing instructions. So this feature is very important, as it has practical importance. So So this completes your the unit 2, which discusses about some of the features of the programming languages in general, and in particular the various addressing modes that we can, by which we can write instructions for 8051. Thank you.